Today we'll talk about which factors we believe are the most important in creating a successful ferrofluid display, and we'll also show you how we avoided the main problems that we faced in our previous video about ferrofluid containers.
I'm Simon.
I'm Amun.
Welcome to Applied Procrastination.
We've already made a video where we show most of the process of how to make a ferrofluid container. The results were unsuccessful, but we did mention what went wrong, so in this video we'll mainly focus on the details that was either left out or simplified last time.
There's a ton of stuff that we don't understand about ferrofluid, but after we released our first videos on Twitter and YouTube, we were contacted by several people with a lot more experience than us and with some really cool ferrofluid portfolios. For example, you should check out the awesome kinetic ferrofluid sculptures of Casey Hughes and the Papel mission that a team from the University of Stuttgart recently flew on the International Space Station.
We have been discussing a bit back and forth with these people, and even though we'll most likely continue with our own tests, their advice has been super helpful. We'll also look for the opportunity to get an appearance from some people with more experience than us on this show.
Before we go into the details on how we treat our container, let's take a minute to discuss how it's actually constructed. We can't really tell you how it's constructed though, because we had some help from our university's scientific lab glass blowing facility to make it, and we don't really know how they did it.
This was before we started the idea of making YouTube videos, so we didn't care a huge deal about how it was done, but we will most likely redo this in the future because of a small mix-up that resulted in our container being a tad too small for our magnet matrix. So remaking this one is actually a top priority for us as soon as we start to improve on our design.
But we won't remake anything until we have the whole display working. Anyway, the tank is made from a pair of 2mm glass plates that are separated with a 6mm glass frame along the edges. They're glued together with epoxy, and this is generally not considered to be a very good design for a ferrofluid tank, because the flat glass and the introduction of epoxy increases the rate at which the ferrofluid degrades compared to, for example, a custom blown glass tank in one whole piece. But the visual expression that we want means that we just have to accept this flaw and expect the ferrofluid to degrade faster.
We have also heard about other projects that use acrylic instead of glass. However, glass is considered a better material, and we do not know if the plastic needs some sort of super hydrophobic coating in order to not get stained, but it could be a possible replacement given that it's much easier to work with than glass. However, one of the biggest benefits of using acrylic is that it can be chemically welded using acetone, so that no adhesive needs to get in contact with the ferrofluid.
One of the most important factors for a successful container is that the surface inside is as clean and smooth as possible when the ferrofluid is poured in.
When we attempted to clean the prototype a few weeks back, we actually gave the big tank the same base treatment.
But when we checked the results afterwards, it wasn't very clean.
We thought maybe the base bath was starting to lose its effect.
Amun, what do you say we make an entirely new base bath from scratch?
Yeah, sure. I'll have one chemical please and mix in one alcohol while you're at it.
Are you saying that we're not competent enough to do it? Amish!
It's you!
How are you, gentlemen?
All your base or belong to us?
You are on your way to destruction. Please follow me to the lab.
Main screen turn on. It's you.
How are you, gentlemen? All your base are belong to us. You are on the way to destruction.
What you say?
You have no chance to survive, made your time. Ha ha ha.
We'll make 75 grams of sodium hydroxide with 2.5 liters of ethanol in order to make a really strong base. This is obviously very dangerous, so if you're doing this at home or anywhere else, be careful and use the right protective equipment. The sodium hydroxide needed more than a week to dissolve. It was actually not completely dissolved when we came back, but we stirred around a bit and now we are almost ready to treat the tank. First, we just want to verify that the base is up for the task. to verify that we managed to create a good base bath, we wanted to measure the pH in the base bath. But what is actually pH and what does it tell us? To understand pH, we can start by looking at water. When we have pure water, some trace amounts of water will always dissolve into hydroxide ions and protons. The product between the concentration of these two will lead to the ionic product of water, which is called Kw. This product will always be constant and equal to 10 to the minus 14th. To calculate the pH, we take the negative logarithm of the concentration of protons to get the pH value. To give some examples, for a neutral solution, when we have equal amounts of hydroxide ions and protons, we have a pH 7. That corresponds to 10 to the minus 7th molar of both the protons and the hydroxide ions. In an acidic solution, the pH is between 0 and 7, for example 3. Then the concentration of protons will be 10 to the minus 3rd molar, and the concentration of hydroxide ions will be 10 to the minus 11th molar. The product of these two will also be 10 to the minus 14. For a basic solution with a pH, for example, of 11, it will be turned around so that the concentration of protons will be 10 to the minus 11, and the concentration of hydroxide ions will be 10 to the minus 3rd. To control the ratio between protons and hydroxide ions in our solution, we can add, for example, sodium hydroxide, which is a strong base. When sodium hydroxide is dissolved in water, we get sodium ions and hydroxide ions. The hydroxide ions will interfere with this equation, where the excess hydroxide ions will react with protons and form more water. So then the reaction will be moved more towards the left. This will change the ratio between the hydroxide ions and the protons, but the product between them will still be 10 to the minus 14th. In our solution, we have ethanol and sodium hydroxide. And the pH indicators, for example the pH strips that we are using in this project, are only made to measure the pH in aqueous solutions. Therefore, we didn't get a significant response when we used the pH strip to measure the basic solution directly. Therefore, we had to dilute our basic solution with 10 times the amount of water. Then the pH value would be 1 unit lower than it initially was. When we had diluted the solution in water, we measured that the pH was 14, which is the maximum of our scale. So we at least know that our solution is very basic and at least a pH of 15, which is out of the scale. We have a very basic solution.
Now that we have verified that our new base is actually basic, we'll throw in the tank. As we did last time, we'll let it sit for about an hour and a half.
As mentioned earlier, the reason that we treat the glass in base at all is that we want to clean it and hopefully remove all the organic material on the surface.
If there are scratches or other impurities, the iron particles in the ferrofluid will stick to the glass. This will quickly ruin the visual display, and over time the ferrofluid itself will also degrade. Therefore, it is also important to keep all beakers and other equipment as clean as possible. Ideally, you give this the same treatment as the display itself.
But that's only for the most hardcore enthusiasts.
Alternative cleaning agents could be acids such as vinegar or hydrochloric acid. Bottles that have contained alcohols are also reported to be good for ferrofluid displays. So if you're going to make a desk toy, the best option for your project is most likely just an old perfume bottle or a glass vinegar bottle. In our case, we need the flat form factor in order to make a usable display. And since we have the opportunity, we treat the glass in a strong base.
To really make sure that the display will last a long time, all materials need to be tested for compatibility with each other. And to be honest, we haven't attempted to go down that road yet. In our case, we are happy with the display that stays clear and has minimal coagulation throughout the first year or so.
Now, let's make some saltwater brine following the same procedure as last time. Saturating distilled water with molten salt, then filtering it twice. We just want to stress that keeping everything clean is extremely important. Unless you're bored and need to procrastinate.
Now we need to get the tank back out of the base bath.
We improvised this fancy contraption from two old coat hangers, and it actually worked really well.
A highly basic coating, so we need to get it neutralized without introducing contamination. So we use distilled water. A lot of distilled water.
Fill the tank entirely with saltwater brine. This is where we made the mistake last time, as we filled it with perifluid as well. But this time, we're gonna let the salt water stay in the tank for a week. So we make a temporary seal with some parafilm and give the brine some time to settle.
That's all for today. In the next video, we'll fill the tank with ferrofluid, seal it properly, and see how it holds up.
In the last video, I told you how we're having trouble with meeting the tight schedule that we've set ourselves up for.
Yeah. We kind of set ourselves up for failure. Tip number one when you want to create a YouTube channel on procrastinating is don't say you'll post weekly videos when you also have full-time jobs.
Anyway, we found out that uploading videos every 2 weeks is also too often, so unfortunately we're going to have to change our schedule again. There's only going to be a new video every third week from now on.
But if you think that's too long to wait for our next video, maybe we'll find some of the behind-the-scenes stuff that we post on social media is interesting.
Also, make sure that you subscribe and click that little bell button so you won't miss our next video when it's finally up.
Thank you for following our project. Until next time,
happy procrastinating! Are you saying that we're not competent enough to do it? Anish, help!
It's you!
How are you, gentlemen?
All your base or belong to us?
You are on your way to destruction. Please follow me to the lab.